All right, welcome back everyone to our For Bartow video series. And we are excited to present this to you all as a benefit to our community to talk through what's happening as we all go through coronavirus together. And so today we are joined by Chris Mosley, who is the CEO of Cartersville Medical Center. And I must say that we have tried really hard. In fact, Chris was on my list from the very beginning, but I know that he and his team have been extremely busy. And for one reason or another, sometimes on our end, sometimes on his, it's taken a little while to get this one to take place. I can't tell you how appreciative I am that you have joined us. So welcome and thank you for being with us.
Oh, absolutely. Happy to do it. Happy to talk and provide some additional information.
Okay, fantastic. Well, let's just do that then. One of the things, let me start by just saying thank you. I'll start and I'll end with saying thank you so, so much for your leadership and your team's leadership, specifically in Bartow County through this time. You've been doing a great job of keeping everybody informed, but I know things continue to change. So anytime we have the opportunity to chat, it's a good time to hear kind of the latest. Let's start with the spread. That's what we keep talking about. Where are we? What is the expanse of the spread right now? What are these numbers looking like currently?
Yeah, so we were one of the first in Georgia to get hit and get hit really hard. Obviously, we had an outbreak here. Even if you still look at the number of cases per 100,000 people, we rank really high as a county within the state of Georgia. But, the good news for us is because of the efforts of not only our elected officials, but also, our church pastors, our school superintendents, everybody really just working together and putting social distancing in place. And then people just acting responsibly and not getting together and having large public gatherings, those types of things. We think that we've been able to limit the spread. And so while early on, we as a hospital were hit really hard, meaning that, the number of inpatients that we were taking care of got really high and our ER got really, really busy early on. That's tapered off and that's been really good. And again, I think we have the social distancing that we've done here to thank for that. And so we've done a really good job with that. We now are in a position as a hospital where we only have about 9 positive patients in-house. At one time, we had more than 30. And so that's coming down pretty significantly. Another stat that I like to throw out is of the first 50 tests that we ran, about 65% of those came back as positive. Now, the most recent 50 tests that we put out, only 15% have come back positive. And so it would appear at least that the number and the percentage is decreasing. So the slope of the curve for us has flattened. But it's also in decline. So that's a very positive development for here as a for us here as a community. And then from a hospital standpoint, I mean, it has a number of very important ramifications as well. But again, very proud of the work that our team here has done. We've tried to be a very good community partner. I feel very confident in the work that our team has done, not only our docs and our nurses, our respiratory therapists, our lab team, our environmental services team, and the list just goes on and on of the number of people here in this hospital that have truly just pulled together to take care of their community, because that's what we're here to do, and our bunch has done a great job with that.
You no doubt have a fantastic group of people there. I've said that all along. And then, of course, in a situation like this, they have really risen to the occasion. The community speaks very highly from what we've seen. And, of course, I'm sure firsthand those who have had to be there for health reasons, then I know they feel much the same way. So, thank you again for that. The next thing I wanted to ask about was the lab testing. So mm-hmm. I know when we, early on there was a lot of delays and that sort of thing. So let's talk about what that looks like now.
Yeah, you're right. Early on, it was really frustrating because patients would come in, they would be exhibiting symptoms that were associated with COVID-19, and we would send off to get lab results back. At that time, we didn't have the ability to do in-house testing. Very few hospitals in the state at that point, I think there were only a handful, when this began that had the ability to do in-house testing. So most of us were sending out to external labs and trying to get results back. And the problem was that when all this hit, it hit kind of all at the same time. And so you had this huge increase in demand and the supply just couldn't keep up with it. And so what we were originally promised, which was a 4 to 5 day turnaround time over the course of a couple of weeks, turned into a 10 to 14 day turnaround time. And that was really problematic for us. And it was really frustrating, I know, for patients and family members, because they're thinking, you know, it's been 2 weeks and I still don't know whether I've had COVID-19 or not. That's wildly inappropriate. And we agreed. We ended up changing external vendors actually a couple of different times. And we now have the ability to, when we send something out, to get it back in about 48 hours. And so that's been a significant improvement for us. And so if you come to our ER and you're exhibiting COVID-19 symptoms, if we discharge you back home and ask you to quarantine, we should have those results in about 48 hours. If, however, you come inside and you you get admitted to the hospital, meaning that you're going to stay overnight with us, then we now have in-house testing. And so we're able to get those results back in about a couple of hours. And so that's really been a game changer for us, and something that we did starting on Friday was this in-house testing. But we've only had it up for a few days, but it's working exceptionally well. And like I said, for our inpatient population, we're able to get results back for them in only a couple of hours. And again, that's much different than it was a few weeks ago, where, you know, just our inpatient population was, it was all suspected COVID patients, because everybody kind of had the same symptoms and everything. And we had a really hard time ruling those patients out because we didn't have lab results back. Now we're sort of past that, it looks like, because we have the in-house capability. And then even if you come to us and you are symptomatic, and even if we send you home because you're getting discharged, then we're going to be able to give you those results within about 48 hours now. So significant improvement. I think supply is now catching up with demand, not just for us, but with a lot of other hospitals across the state and across the country. But that's been a significant development for us just within the last couple of weeks or so.
Okay, great. And so now that more testing is available and there are quicker turnarounds, it might be helpful for a little bit of guidance too, again, for the viewers. When should you come? I mean, and quite candidly, I've heard people say, well, I'd just love to have the test to know if I had it, because so many people could be asymptomatic. So a little bit of guidance maybe around that, Chris. When should somebody come in, and what do you see for the future of testing, you know, if people just never had symptoms?
So we're not there yet. I don't think as a healthcare system, and that's not specific to our hospital, but I think as a healthcare system, the guideline is still only go if you're symptomatic. Okay. If you're not symptomatic, continue to social distance, continue to take precautions, continue to isolate yourself, and don't interact with others as much as possible. But if you are symptomatic, if you are feeling bad, if you're running a fever, if you've got a significant cough or shortness of breath, or if you're immunocompromised to begin with, meaning you've got an underlying condition, or you're elderly and you're experiencing one of these symptoms, then yeah, it's still okay to seek care. It's still okay to go to your doctor's office or do a telehealth visit or go to a local urgent care. Obviously, we've got our urgent care. We've seen a number of telehealth visits now. We also have testing capability there. But the one thing that we're very much trying to encourage everyone is, if you're in a medical emergency, you still come to the emergency room. We've heard too many stories of people really putting that off for fear of COVID-19. And, you know, we're here to tell you that we've got precautions in place and protocols in place to ensure that people who come to our ER are not being needlessly exposed to COVID-19. We do have separate areas for suspected COVID patients versus not. And our staff are doing just an exceptional job of staying within the guidelines, wearing their personal protective equipment so that we minimize transition, not just for our staff members, but from patient to patient as well. And so that would really be the message as it relates to seeking testing, or more importantly, seeking care. You know, just doing it that way. Because one of the other things that we're finding is that these symptoms are overlapping with other diseases, some of which are treatable, and some things that you can impact with a Z-Pak or something to that effect. But if it is COVID and you've got symptoms, then you probably want to know that so that we can at least monitor and understand if you get worse, then we'll probably need to get you back in the hospital.
Okay. Oh, that's great to know, honestly, even if it's not symptoms for COVID, but, you know, because there's probably some concern about whether it's ER or just regular doctor visits, maybe I should put things off, but you all are the experts. You've had time, I'm sure, now to adjust to the, you know, what it looks like now. So that's reassuring to know that it's certainly fine to come in and see your doctor or to go to the emergency room as needed. So.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, let's talk. You mentioned personal protective equipment, and that's been a big topic in the news media. How's your team? What's the supply of PPE for your staff?
You know, one of the, and so the first two things that we talked about, which was just the spread and the exposure and how we've been able to flatten the curve, and then also lab testing, that plays directly into and is tied with PPE utilization. So for those that aren't aware, PPE, personal protective equipment, that's going to be, you know, an N95 mask, so not just a regular surgical mask like I wear here in the hospital, but truly an N95 mask that creates a tight seal around your mouth and your nose, and that prevents the intake, if you will, of the COVID-19. And so we require our staff who are interacting with COVID-19 patients to wear one of these masks. And early on, because of some supply disruption that was taking place, not just nationally, but internationally, N95s became really not just valuable, but sort of hard to come by. And so we never had a problem. We never had our supply disrupted significantly, but we put protocols in place very early on to preserve and conserve our PPE. And so what flattening the curve did is it meant that fewer patients were coming in. If fewer patients were coming in, then we had to use less PPE for them and so doing that helped us preserve our PPE. It's the same way with lab testing. If we're not able to rule someone out as having COVID-19, then we have to treat them as if they're COVID-19 until we get those results back. And so that was yet another one of the reasons why a 10 to 14 day turnaround time was so frustrating for us, is that you're burning through all that PPE because you can't rule those patients out. Mm-hmm. Now that we can rule those patients out much more quickly, we're able to use a lot less PPE, and because of the social distancing, because we've been able to flatten our curve, we don't have this huge peak that we've hit, meaning that we didn't have to burn through all of our PPE, and we're able to shift that curve further back. And by shifting the curve further back, that allowed us to ensure that our supply was stocked. It allowed essentially us to catch back up on supply replenishment. And so that was very positive for us. If you think about what our current state is and what we're going to be in the future, we're actually really good on PPE right now. That doesn't mean that if we got another huge surge and we hit sort of another peak that we wouldn't go back to the situation that we were in. But as of right now, based on the conservation and the program that we put in place, based on our relationship as being a member of HCA Healthcare and not having our supply disrupted because we've just got a team of people who are sourcing all of this stuff around the globe right now, it's allowed us to work with a lot of confidence, not have to worry about having to compromise our colleagues' safety, our team's safety, and then that of the patients as well. We've been able to ensure that we're using the right PPE at the right time with the right patients, and that's something that early on we set as a goal, is not to have to compromise around. Unfortunately, not every hospital in the country has been able to do that, and that's why you've seen a lot of these cloth masks being fabricated, and that's, you know, if you don't have anything, then you use what you've got. Luckily, we've not had to do that here at Cartersville Medical Center, and that's something I'm very proud of.
Yes. Yes. Okay, well, and that makes us feel good for you as well, that we are in that fortunate situation. So it's good to know that our healthcare professionals here are in good hands and well taken care of. Absolutely. Well, as we start to wrap up, there's one other question that I kind of wanted to chat with you, because this is sort of that feel good story. We love highlighting the good things our community is doing and the prayer service. As of now, it's been a couple weeks ago, I know. But still, I would love to hear your thoughts. I was completely unaware of this until I actually saw it on the news and realized what had happened. And so I know a group of people had come out and just kind of surrounded the hospital. And we all, probably much of the community, already saw all the clips and the films and all that. But how cool was that? It brought tears to my eyes. So I'm just curious, as the CEO and there in that hospital every day and seeing what's happening, what are your thoughts on that?
It meant everything to us. I mean, that was a really difficult time that we were going through, especially then. That's when, you know, everybody was just so tired. We'd been working, you know, at that point, I think 2 weeks straight, pretty much everybody, including weekends. And, you know, we were just going nonstop trying to figure things out. I mean, there's no instruction manual for this because we've not really dealt with this before. And so, you know, for our team, one, to be recognized, I thought meant a lot to all of us, and to be acknowledged. But then beyond that, not just a, hey, we see you, but to know sort of that next level, at least for us, was that we're praying for you and that we're behind you. That meant everything to our staff. I mean, it really did. Just the number of people that I interacted with after that, just seeing, you know, the reach and where this was being shared on social media nationally, and you know, you had celebrities that were sharing it and things like that. It meant a lot. It meant a whole lot to our staff, certainly for it to get out, but more specifically, the most meaningful part is it meant that our community was behind us, and that our community was recognizing the sacrifices that our clinical teams and you know, the people that were coming here we're making every single day to take care of this community, because that's what they care about. And that's something that, you know, not everyone might understand, but that's, you know, the people that work here oftentimes are the people that you see in the local grocery stores or, you know, out at a restaurant or something like that. This is their community, and this is what's important to them. And so they see this as their mission, is to take care of this community. And so to know that the community was behind them and that community members were praying for them and lifting them up, that meant, again, everything. I mean, that was a big deal for all of us. And, you know, us going out on the roof just started out as we just wanted to kind of see, because there was no other way to sort of see everything all the way around. And then when we got up there, you know, one of our directors had the idea that, you know, let's take part in the prayer as well, but we also got to make sure that we're staying 6 feet apart. And so we're trying to do that. And, you know, normally we would hold hands when we would do that, but we couldn't really do that at that point. So we tried to stay at a distance, but then also pray. And so it meant a lot. It felt great. And I think, you know, that's something that just put a little bit more fuel in the tank for all of us here, and especially our team that's taking care of these patients. It just put a little bit more fuel in their tank just to keep going. And so it meant a lot, and it's greatly appreciated. And I think it's a testament to the just the type of community that we have here in Cartersville-Bartow County. And so we feel honored as the only hospital in this county to be able to take care of the wonderful people here. And again, just to see that acknowledgement and the support meant a ton to everybody.
Yeah, it gives me cold chills as you talk about it all over again. Yeah. So certainly, I wish I had thought of it myself, but when I saw that, I beamed with pride for our community, and because it's so much deserved by, you know, your staff. So, yeah, I thank you for sharing those thoughts. And I think everybody will be excited to hear that, too, just from a firsthand experience. So. Yeah. Well, Chris, thank you again. You all are doing a phenomenal job. As you start out saying, you're here to support us as the Bartow County community, and you have no doubt done that. And please relay that to your staff as well, how deeply grateful that we are. I mean, from my seat with the Chamber of Commerce, your partnership was long before this ever happened. So it really was not a surprise that you all were able to step up, but I know it has meant a lot of extra hours, a lot of extra energy, and we cannot be more grateful for that. So we are deeply thankful, and I appreciate you joining me on here today as well.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thanks, Chris. Bye-bye. Bye.